Now, here is the formal definition of a prebiotic. Now, this might seem complicated, but what this means simply is that prebiotics are food for the good bacteria in the gut and can turbocharge them, improving our health. The very first prebiotic discovered is inulin. Inulin is a type of fiber found in many plants, including asparagus, chicory root, garlic, Jerusalem artichoke, onions, and leeks. It is classed as a fructan, which refers to chains of fructose molecules linked up in such a way that it can't be digested by the small intestine. It travels to the colon where it becomes a fuel source for bacteria such as Bifidobacterium and Lactobacillus. These bacteria are able to selectively ferment the inulin to produce the short-chain fatty acids lactate and acetate. Now, short-chain fatty acids have a number of very beneficial properties. For the gut, these include the ability to absorb water from the colon, stimulate bowel movements, thereby improving constipation and providing nourishment to the colonocytes, which are the cells lining the colon. Research also shows that short-chain fatty acids have anti-inflammatory effects and can affect how energy is metabolized in the body. Some researchers have suggested that it's more important to focus on the overall diversity and richness of gut microbiota rather than individual bacterial species when talking about the benefits of prebiotics. In 2017, an international consensus revised the definition of a prebiotic as a substrate that is selectively utilized by host microorganisms conferring a health benefit. The term substrate was chosen because it means a substance from which an organism obtains nourishment. This definition helps exclude substances such as antibiotics from being classified as prebiotics. The term selectively was kept, but its reference is now in regards to utilization by microbes. In other words, the microbes actually have to utilize the prebiotics in order to improve human health. The guidelines around the new definition also suggest that prebiotics shouldn't cause excess gas distension issues in humans. Some of my patients have a lot of issues with gas, particularly bloating, distension, and flatulence. The reason why a low FODMAPs diet is encouraged for these patients is because it's been shown that avoiding FODMAPs can reduce gaseous symptoms. Well, guess what? Many FODMAPs, which stand for the super long official title, fermentable oligosaccharides, disaccharides, monosaccharides, and polyols, are actually prebiotics. The newer definition tries to emphasize that prebiotics shouldn't be forming gas distension issues, but due to the breadth of the newer definition, many FODMAPs would be classed as prebiotics. Under the new definition, a prebiotic doesn't have to be confined to the gut. It can be applied to any microbial ecosystem, such as the vagina or skin. The reality is that prebiotics for the gut have been by far the most extensively researched, and it's from that data that we can draw some meaningful conclusions. Hope this has been a helpful video. As always, leave your questions down below, and if you like this video, please subscribe to the Gut Doctor channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.